The webinar will begin shortly. Please remain on the line.
JSW Steel is aiding growth in building the infrastructure that keeps the nation's heart throbbing. From steel that holds bridges and skyscrapers to steel that builds the railway coursing through the land, JSW Steel is the one name that does it all and stands strong.
In spite of spending millions of dollars, I always get outdated technologies from the global plant suppliers.
Hello sir, I am InSmart. I have been associated with the steel making industry for the past 27 years.
Okay, how do I jump from 110 to 300 million tons per annum?
I understand the intricacies of process control requirements and your requirements in Indian steel plants thoroughly. Right from run of mine ore to steel conversion at all the stages.
Oh, I see. How do I produce consistent quality steel?
I provide complete range of customized, end-to-end, sophisticated automated solutions, service support and in-house manpower training, resulting in real-time analysis data for the process control and plant performance optimization at a rapid pace.
Sounds impressive. Let's work together.
I am at your service, sir.
InSmart Systems. Reliable analytical support since 1993. InSmart improves quality, productivity, and profitability.
स्टील टीएमटी महाशक्तिशाली
भूलोक का एडवांस्ड वाई रिब्ड सुपर शक्ति टीएमटी बार जो देता है सीमेंट के साथ मजबूत पकड़
और हर निर्माण को बनाता है
सुपर शक्ति से सुपर स्ट्रॉन्ग
JSW Steel is aiding growth in building the infrastructure that keeps the nation's heart throbbing. From steel that holds bridges and skyscrapers to steel that builds the railway coursing through the land, JSW Steel is the one name that does it all and stands strong.
In spite of spending millions of dollars, I always get outdated technologies from the global plant suppliers.
Hello sir, I am InSmart. I have been associated with the steel making industry for the past 27 years.
Okay, how do I jump from 110 to 300 million tons per annum?
I understand the intricacies of process control requirements and your requirements in Indian steel plants thoroughly. Right from run of mine ore to steel conversion at all the stages.
Oh, I see. How do I produce consistent quality steel?
I provide complete range of customized, end-to-end, sophisticated automated solutions, service support and in-house manpower training, resulting in real-time analysis data for the process control and plant performance optimization at a rapid pace.
Sounds impressive. Let's work together.
I am at your service, sir.
InSmart Systems. Reliable analytical support since 1993. InSmart improves quality, productivity, and profitability.
550 स्टील TMT महाशक्तिशाली।
भूलोक का एडवांस्ड वाई रिब्ड सुपर शक्ति TMT बार जो देता है सीमेंट के साथ मजबूत पकड़
और हर निर्माण को बनाता है
सुपर शक्ति से सुपर स्ट्रॉन्ग।
The webinar will begin shortly. Please remain on the line. The webinar will begin shortly. Please remain on the line.
JSW Steel is aiding growth in building the infrastructure that keeps the nation's heart throbbing. From steel that holds bridges and skyscrapers to steel that builds the railway coursing through the land, JSW Steel is the one name that does it all and stands strong.
In spite of spending millions of dollars, I always get outdated technologies from the global plant suppliers.
Hello sir, I am InSmart. I have been associated with the steel making industry for the past 27 years.
Okay, how do I jump from 110 to 300 million tons per annum?
I understand the intricacies of process control requirements and your requirements in Indian steel plants thoroughly, right from run-of-mine ore to steel conversion at all the stages. Oh, I see. How do I produce consistent quality steel? I provide complete range of customized, end-to-end, sophisticated automated solutions, service support and in-house manpower training, resulting in real-time analysis data for the process control and plant performance optimization at a rapid pace. Sounds impressive. Let's work together. I am at your service, sir.
InSmart Systems. Reliable analytical support since 1993. InSmart improves quality, productivity, and profitability. स्टील टीएमटी महाशक्तिशाली
भूलोक का एडवांस्ड वाई रिब्ड सुपर शक्ति टीएमटी बार जो देता है सीमेंट के साथ मजबूत पकड़
और हर निर्माण को बनाता है
सुपर शक्ति से सुपर स्ट्रॉन्ग।
Good afternoon, namaskar, hello, and welcome to everyone. Thank you for joining us for today's webinar. My name is Monica Bachchan. I'm a founder of Metallurgic Projects Management Services. हम इसे maximum women staff organization कहते हैं क्योंकि Metallurgic में 80% women staff काम करते हैं. Today on 16th of February, we are presenting you webinar on investment opportunities in mining, iron and steel in India. Webinar sponsored by JSW Steel, Rungta Sons Private Limited, InSmart Systems, Atha Group, and American Steel. Our associate partners are Radha TMT and Super Shakti TMT. Ye hamara 28th webinar hai COVID pandemic mein. And I hope aapne hamare last webinar जो कि आयरन और पैलेट के ऊपर था 5th फरवरी को आपने उसमें इनसाइट गेन किया होगा. उसका रिकॉर्डेड वर्जन वेबिनार का हमारे यूट्यूब चैनल पे अवेलेबल है. उसको देखने के लिए आपको जाना होगा youtube.com/metallurgictms. इन केस आपको गो टू वेबिनार सॉफ्टवेयर पे वेबिनार अटेंड करने में अगर कोई प्रॉब्लम होती है तो ये वेबिनार अभी यूट्यूब पे भी लाइव है, आप उस पे भी इसको देख सकते हैं. जस्ट अ शॉर्ट हाउसकीपिंग बिफोर वी गेट स्टार्टेड, अगर आपके कोई सवाल होंगे तो आप उनको आपके गो टू वेबिनार पैनल के क्वेश्चन बॉक्स में टाइप कर सकते हैं। पैनलिस्ट डेलिब्रेशंस के बाद हम वो क्वेश्चंस एक एक करके सभी पैनलिस्ट से लेंगे। हमेशा अपने कंपनी नेम एंड ऑर्गेनाइजेशन नेम को मेंशन करिए, अपना नाम एंड ऑर्गेनाइजेशन नेम जो आप रिप्रेजेंट करते हैं। बिफोर वी स्टार्ट, मैं आपको एक ब्रीफ देना चाहती हूँ इस वेबिनार के बारे में। आप देख सकते हैं अपने स्क्रीन पे, जो स्टील सेक्टर है इंडिया का वो वर्ल्ड वाइड काफी आगे पहुंच चुका है। हमारी जितनी भी स्टील कंपनीज हैं बड़ी और छोटी, उन्होंने काफी काम किया है पिछले 10-20 सालों में, एंड अब हम उस स्टेज पर हैं कि ये बैकबोन कहलाता है इंडियन इकोनॉमी का। जो लेवल है पर कैपिटा इनकम ऑफ स्टील वो सोशियो इकोनॉमिक ग्रोथ के बेसिस पे बढ़ रहा है। मेक इन इंडिया इनिशिएटिव एंड प्रधानमंत्री नरेंद्र मोदी जी के जो इनिशिएटिव्स रहे हैं उससे स्टील इंडस्ट्री को बहुत बूस्ट मिला है। जो हमारा एम है 300 मिलियन टन स्टील प्रोड्यूस करने का बाय 2031, उसमें स्टील इन्वेस्टमेंट का बहुत बड़ा रोल है। अब उस स्टील इन्वेस्टमेंट को बढ़ाने के लिए बहुत सारे सरकार कदम उठा रही है, बहुत सारी फैसिलिटेशन करी जा रही है एफडीआई इन्वेस्टमेंट्स के लिए, और डोमेस्टिकली जितने ग्रीन फील्ड प्लांट्स लग रहे हैं या ब्राउन फील्ड प्लांट्स या एक्सपेंशन हैं एग्जिस्टिंग स्टील प्लांट्स के, उनकी बहुत इम्पोर्टेंस है जिसको अब सरकार पूरी तरह से सपोर्ट करना चाहती है। उसी के उपलक्ष में हमने ये वेबिनार ऑर्गेनाइज किया है। आज के हमारे चीफ गेस्ट हैं श्री फग्गन सिंह कुलस्ते, ऑनरेबल मिनिस्टर ऑफ स्टेट एट मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ स्टील। हमारे एक्सपर्ट पैनलिस्ट हैं श्री पी मधुसूदन, एडवाइजर एट वाईएसआर स्टील कॉरपोरेशन लिमिटेड। मिस्टर शनमोगन सागीली, आईएएस एमडी, वो हमें ज्वाइन नहीं कर पाए हैं, उनकी जगह मिस्टर पी मधुसूदन कवर करेंगे। वी हैव डॉक्टर विनोद नोवल, डेप्यूटी एमडी एट जेएसडब्ल्यू स्टील। मिस्टर जॉयदीप भट्टाचार्य, एमडी एट थिसनक्रप इलेक्ट्रिकल स्टील इंडिया। मिस्टर टीएस कथायत, President and CTO at Wellspin Corp Limited, Mr. Anshul Gupta, Project Leader at BCG India, Ms. Rubana Rahman, Investment Specialist, M&M at Invest India. To start with, I would like to request Dr. Vinod Noval, Deputy Managing Director of JSW Steel, to please open the session and set the theme of the webinar. Dr. Noble,
Namaskar.
Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Monica ji. Good afternoon, Namaskar. Sir, pratham main mukhya atithi mananiye Sri Fagan Singh Kulaste ji, Kendriya Ispat Rajya Mantri ka hardik swagat karta hoon. Is webinar par hamare anya mukhya atithiyon और मेरे को पैनलिस्ट का भी स्वागत करता हूं, श्री ज्योदी भट्टाचार्य जी, श्री टीएस कटायत, श्री टीएस कटाय जी, श्री अंशुल गुप्ता जी, सुश्री रुमाना रहमान जी। आई वुड लाइक टू बिगिन बाय थैंकिंग मोनिका एंड मेटलोजी फॉर हैविंग अस हियर and for organizing this interesting and inclusive webinar to create a platform for us to discuss the investment opportunities in mining, iron and steel industry in India. Is webinar ka subject and focus investment opportunities. Ya nivesh ke avsar ek bahut hi mazboot sakaratmak और आश्वस्त करने वाला संदेश देता है कि अब पुनः आर्थिक गतिविधियां तेजी से बढ़ रही हैं। विशेष रूप से हमारे आयरन, स्टील एंड माइनिंग उद्योग पुनः सक्रिय रूप से अपना खोया वर्चस्व प्राप्त करने के लिए अग्रसर हैं और अथक प्रयास कर रहे हैं। इस वैश्विक महामारी COVID-19 ने हमारे सामने कई चुनौतियां पेश की, लेकिन साथ ही साथ हमने उन्हें दूर करने के लिए तरीके, साधन और समाधान भी खोज लिए। विशेषकर हमारी आयरन स्टील इंडस्ट्री ने हाल ही के दिनों में जबरदस्त रिजिलेंस और पेशेंस दिखाया है। भारतीय इस्पात उद्योग ने पोस्ट कोविड सिचुएशन के बाद विकास के एक नए दौर में प्रवेश किया है, जिसमें इंडियन इकोनॉमी के रिवाइवल के साथ साथ स्टील की डिमांड भी तेजी से बढ़ती जा रही है। स्टील इंडस्ट्री भारत के विकास और उसे 5 ट्रिलियन USD इकोनॉमी बनाने के लिए बहुत अहम और निर्णायक है। आयरन स्टील इंडस्ट्री की ग्रोथ ड्रिवन सेक्टर जैसे कंस्ट्रक्शन, इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर, मैन्युफैक्चरिंग एवं रेलवेज में एक प्रमुख भागीदारी रही है। उत्पादन में तेजी से वृद्धि के कारण आज भारत क्रूड स्टील में विश्व का दूसरा सबसे बड़ा उत्पादक बन गया है। आज दुनिया में स्पॉन्ज आयरन या DRI के भी सबसे बड़े उत्पादक भी हैं। आज हम चीन और अमेरिका के बाद दुनिया में स्टील के तीसरे सबसे बड़े उपभोक्ता भी हैं। हालांकि दुनिया के दूसरे सबसे बड़े स्टील प्रोड्यूसर होने के बावजूद भारत की प्रति व्यक्ति स्टील कंजम्पशन अभी भी लगभग 74 kg है, जो ग्लोबल कंजम्पशन एवरेज 224.5 kg की सिर्फ 1/3 है। अगर हमें माननीय प्रधानमंत्री मोदी जी के मेक इन इंडिया के 300 मिलियन टन के सपने को पूरा करना है, तो हमें इस दशक में सन 2030 तक लगभग 155 से 170 केजी तक प्रति व्यक्ति स्टील कंजम्पशन को बढ़ाना पड़ेगा। हालांकि इस वर्ष का बजट इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर एवं कंस्ट्रक्शन सेक्टर में बढ़े हुए इन्वेस्टमेंट के माध्यम से स्टील डिमांड को बढ़ाने में काफी सक्षम है, क्योंकि स्टील एवं आयरन की 60% से अधिक मांग इन्हीं सेक्टर से जनरेट होती है। हम माननीय इस्पात मंत्री कुलस्ती जी को आश्वस्त करना चाहते हैं कि स्टील सेक्टर अब विकास के एक नए चरण, एक नए युग में प्रवेश कर चुका है और पहले से भी अधिक वाइब्रेंट, कॉम्पिटिटिव और सस्टेनेबल बनने की ओर अग्रसर है। मुझे विश्वास है माननीय इस्पात मंत्री जी कि आपके नेतृत्व में इस वेबिनार आत्मनिर्भर भारत और विकास हेतु आयरन और स्टील के साथ साथ माइनिंग में नई संभावनाओं और इन्वेस्टमेंट अपॉर्चुनिटीज की बातचीत और ब्रेनस्टॉर्मिंग के लिए एक बेहतरीन मंच साबित होगा। दिस इज सिंस आई एम फ्रॉम द JSW स्टील, आई वुड लाइक टू कवर व्हाट इज अ ब्राउनफील्ड एंड ग्रीनफील्ड प्रोजेक्ट्स एंड इन्वेस्टमेंट्स JSW स्टील इज हैविंग। सिंस माननीय मंत्री जी हमारे साथ में है, तो कुछ मेरे इश्यूज हैं इंडस्ट्रीज के, हम लोग चाहते हैं उनकी नॉलेज में लेके आए जिससे कुछ निदान हम उनसे ले सके। एंड आई वंस अगेन ग्रीट यू सर एंड माई फेलो इंडस्ट्री सॉल्वर्स। वी आर थैंकफुल टू द गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया फॉर आर्टिकुलेटिंग सच ए डेवलपमेंट oriented and industrial friendly budget. The highlights are truly inclusive and are going to boost not only the industry, steel industry that I represent, but also the economy as a whole. JSW Steel is one of the most efficient steel producers in India, with an ability to expand capacity swiftly at low cost, and our present capacity, 18 million ton, will be increasing to 23 million ton as we will be adding 5 million ton at Dolvi in Maharashtra in this financial year, coming financial year. In line with government's Make in India vision of increasing Indian steel making capacity to 300 million ton by 2030-31 and be an integral partner of Honorable Prime Minister Shri Narendra Modi ji's Atmanirbhar Bharat mission, JSW Steel envisions increasing its domestic capacity in India 47 million ton by 2025, in addition to overseas 1.5 million ton capacity in US. The details of our expansions are: on the organic front, Vijayanagar in Karnataka is planning to expand from its current capacity to 12 million to 20 million ton by 2025, with an investment of rupees more than 20,000 crores. The Dolvi in Maharashtra will see expansion from 5 to 10 million FY22 and then 14 million ton by FY25 with an investment of rupees 15,000 crores. JSW has also taken up a very challenging task to set up 20 million ton per annum capacity steel plant in Odisha in Paradip, which is in its nascent stage, with an investment of 1,47,000 crores over US$2 billion. JSW Steel other projects include modernization cum capacity enhancement at its downstream value added products facilities in JSW Steel coated products to the tune of 4,000 crores. And all the projects are almost in completion stage. On the environmental front, a key considerations which we ensure while executing these projects is that all equipment should have best in class environmental attributes and should meet environmental emission standards. As a largest steel maker, we depend on natural resources for our operations across the value chain. We strive to reduce the usage of water, energy, and other resources and recycle them wherever it is possible. While enhancing the capacities, JSW Steel is committed to safeguard environment to the utmost extent by adopting technology which is energy efficient, saves water, and eco-friendly. JSW gives most importance to recycling of the waste, recycling of waste and practices, the mantra on W2W, wealth to wealth. We are currently utilizing 92% of our solid waste. That is one of the concerns whole of the world, especially LD slag. But Mantri ji, aapki knowledge ke liye main batana cha raha hun, JSW Steel has achieved solid recycling of the waste 92% and is coming financial year mein, the 92% we are going to utilize 98%. Only 2% of the solid waste will be a question mark for our industry, which is a concern throughout the world. But we are solving the problem by doing the LD slag conversion into the alternate of the river sand. JSW Steel has installed a state of art 25 kilometer long pipe conveyor belt first of its kind in India to transport iron ore from mines to Vijayanagar steel plant. This has ascertained that there is no dust, no spillages, no truck for transportation, which has further lowered the company's carbon footprint while improving safety through zero road accidents. We have deployed various new age technologies, including Industry 4.0 intervention, such as ML, IoT, and AI. Powered simulations and optimization engines and computer vision to enhance productivity, minimize human interventions, and ensure greater safety across our steel plants.
अभी मंत्री जी को जाना होगा तो उन आपका स्पीच का जो डिटेल है कैन वी टेक इट एक बार मंत्री जी का स्पीच हो जाए उसके बाद सर
ओके ओनली फॉर थ्री फॉर थ्री फॉर फोर पॉइंट्स आई वांटेड टू ब्रिंग इन नोटिस ऑफ द मंत्री जी कि हमारी इंडस्ट्री को क्या चाहिए ये तो हम बता रहे थे कि इंडस्ट्री क्या कर रही है यदि मंत्री जी के पास समय हो तो मैं चाहता था कि अगले दो मिनट एक मिनट के अंदर जो जो दो तीन पॉइंट है मैं बता दूं या फिर हम उनको सुनते हैं मंत्री जी आप बताइए आप कुछ सुनना चाहेंगे हमारी कुछ प्रॉब्लम्स है उनको
मंत्री जी आपका माइक म्यूटेड है सर उसको अनम्यूट कर दीजिए
अभी बात करता हूं मैं जैसे मैं अभी एक मीटिंग थोड़ा हां ठीक ठीक हां नमस्कार
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 जी सर सर नोवल जी पूछना चाह रहे थे आपसे कि वो एक मिनट थोड़ा सा बोलना चाहते हैं अगर आप इजाजत दें
हाँ बोलिए एक मिनट दर्शन दीजिए हाँ
हाँ जी माननीय मंत्री जी हमारी दो तीन बातें हैं हम जो रखना चाह रहे हैं आपके सामने एक तो यह है कि जो कैपेसिटी इन्हांसमेंट हम करना चाह रहे हैं उसमें प्रॉब्लम्स हैं जैसे एक्विजिशन ऑफ द लैंड ग्रांट ऑफ एनवायरनमेंट एंड फॉरेस्ट क्लियरेंसेस अवेलेबिलिटी ऑफ रॉ मटेरियल लिंकेजेस एंड अदर इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर रिलेटेड सपोर्ट्स दूसरा है कोकिंग कोल जो इंडस्ट्रीज को इम्पोर्ट के ऊपर बेस्ड रहता है वो झारखंड में काफी हमारे पास है यदि हम उसको एक्सप्लोर कर सके तीसरा पॉइंट है जो इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर है वेदर रोड रेल और पोर्ट्स उसके ऊपर भी ध्यान देने की जरूरत है वो काफी पुराना है और इतना इकोनॉमिकली इट इज नॉट सपोर्टिंग स्टील इंडस्ट्रीज बिकॉज वी हैव टू कम्पीट विद द वर्ल्ड स्पेशली चाइना तीसरा है जो ट्रांसपोर्टेशन ऑफ आयरन ओर बाय ट्रक्स एंड रेल बहुत ही कॉस्टली है यदि हम लोग स्लरी ट्रांसपोर्टेशन करें और पैरेलल टू हाईवे यदि राइट ऑफ यूज की परमिशन मिलती है तो वो बहुत ही ज्यादा एक सुविधाजनक हो सकता है तीसरा एक लास्ट पॉइंट मेरा है कि इंडस्ट्रीज को आरएनडी के लिए इंसेंटिव प्रोवाइड किया जाए और आरएनडी में इंडिया बहुत ही पीछे है आज हम लोगों को यदि देखें तो वर्ल्ड में जहाँ पे 1-2% ऑफ टर्नओवर आरएनडी पे खर्च होता है वैसा हिंदुस्तान में नहीं है तो हम लोगों को आरएनडी एनवायरमेंट पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू से भी और एनर्जी एफिशिएंसी एंड रिडक्शन ऑफ द ग्रीन हाउस गैस इन सब के ऊपर जो आरएनडी पे खर्च आए उसके ऊपर गवर्नमेंट की तरफ से इंसेंटिव मिलना चाहिए ये हम लोगों की गुजारिश है आप इसका एक कुछ जो आप अपनी नोटिस में रखें कि किस तरीके से हम लोगों को इसमें सुविधा मिल सके मैं मंत्री जी से गुजारिश कि वो अपना मार्ग हम लोगों का मार्गदर्शन करें
थैंक यू डॉक्टर नोवल मंत्री जी
हाँ नमस्कार भारत में खान लोह और इस्पात में निवेश के अवसर और इसे वेबिनार में विशेषकर अभी मैं सुन रहा था कि नोवल जी को श्री जेडी भट्टाचार्य जी डॉक्टर विनोद विनोल जी हमारे अंशुल जी गुप्ता श्रीमती मोनिका जी और अन्य हमारे जो पार्टिसिपेंट हैं, मैं सबको बहुत बहुत बधाई देता हूं और विशेषकर इस वेबिनार में, क्योंकि अभी आपका पैनलिस्ट का भी आगे कार्यक्रम है। और मैं तो केवल इतना कहना चाहता हूं कि इस क्षेत्र में जब हम काम करते हैं तो आज के इस वेबिनार में जो सभी हमारे अतिथि हैं और जो पार्टिसिपेंट है, वक्ता है, उनको भी बधाई देता हूं। और इस तकनीक के माध्यम से जुड़े सभी जो प्रतिभागी हैं, मैं सबको नमस्कार करता हूं। मुझे ये भी जानकर प्रसन्नता है कि भारत में खनन, लोह और इस्पात में जो निवेश के अवसर पर जो संबोधित करते हुए मुझे बहुत खुशी हो रही कि भारत संसाधनों से संपन्न देश है। माइनिंग एवं मेटल सेक्टर देश के समग्र विकास भूमिका निभा रहा है। और इस क्षेत्र में जब हम देखते हैं तो भारत की जो त्वरित जो संबंध है खनन क्षेत्र से होता है, जिस पर विनिर्माण क्षेत्र के अधिकांश
सर आपका आवाज नहीं आ रही है फगन जी, आपका वीडियो पॉज हो गया है सर। ऑडियंस, लगता है थोड़ा टेक्निकल इश्यू हुआ है, वी विल वेट फॉर वन मिनट सर। बीच में आपकी आवाज चली गई थी सर।
मोबाइल से लेकर के स्पेस जैसे
सर आपका माइक म्यूट हो गया है फगन जी। मंत्री जी आपका माइक म्यूट हो गया सर। सर सर दोबारा, यस सर, नाउ दिस इज फाइन।
तो मैं कह रहा था कि स्टील इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर के क्षेत्र में स्टील और अन्य मेटल से लेकर के पावर सेक्टर, ऑटोमोबाइल से लेकर के स्पेस जैसे अनेक क्षेत्रों के लिए महत्वपूर्ण भूमिका निभा रहा है। वर्तमान में भारत में धातु और खनन क्षेत्र का योगदान लगभग 100 मिलियन USD से भी ज्यादा का है। प्रधानमंत्री माननीय नरेंद्र मोदी जी के नेतृत्व में हमारी सरकार का ये जो फोकस आत्मनिर्भर भारत के साथ साथ देश भर में अधोसंरचना के विकास पर प्रमुख जोर देना, देश में खनिज भंडार विशेष रूप से लोह, कोयला, वॉक्साइड, चूना, तांबा, मैग्नीज, क्रोमियम आदि जैसे खनिजों के विकास के लिए आवश्यकता को युक्ति संगत बनाना है, जो आर्थिक विकास की रीढ़ है। कोल तथा इस्पात उद्योग जगत की रीढ़ है। स्टील आधुनिक दुनिया के सबसे महत्वपूर्ण उत्पादकों में से एक है और किसी भी औद्योगिक राष्ट्र के लिए इसका सामरिक महत्व होता है। कंस्ट्रक्शन एवं अवसंरचना के क्षेत्र में इस्पात की खपत लगभग 65% से ज्यादा है। ऑटोमोबाइल और बुनियादी ढांचे के क्षेत्र में निरंतर ग्रोथ के कारण भारत का जो खनन और धातु क्षेत्र के विकास में मजबूती आ रहा है, जिसके परिणाम स्वरूप देश में बिजली, इस्पात, सीमेंट की अधिक मांग हो रही है। देश में खनिजों की विशाल उपलब्धता के कारण खनन और धातु के क्षेत्र में विकास के बड़े अवसर उपलब्ध हो रहे हैं और 24-25 तक देश की जो महत्वाकांक्षी परियोजनाएं आत्मनिर्भर भारत USD 5 ट्रिलियन अर्थव्यवस्था में प्रमुख भूमिका निभा सकता है। प्रधानमंत्री श्री मोदी जी के नेतृत्व में हमारी सरकार ने 24-25 तक 5 ट्रिलियन की जो अर्थव्यवस्था हासिल करने के लिए नेशनल इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर पाइपलाइन में 110 लाख करोड़ रुपए से ज्यादा की राशि खर्च करने का लक्ष्य रखा है, जिसे इस्पात की मांग बढ़ेगी और 24-25 तक इस्पात की मांग 160 मिलियन टन प्रति वर्ष होगी, जिसको प्राप्त करने के लिए 210 मिलियन टन क्रूड इस्पात की क्षमता विकसित करनी पड़ेगी। वर्तमान में भारत में क्रूड इस्पात की क्षमता 142 मिलियन टन की है। राष्ट्रीय इस्पात नीति 2017 के अनुसार भारत में क्रूड इस्पात की जो क्षमता है, हमने 30-31 तक का जो 300 मिलियन टन ले जाना, ये हमारा जो टारगेट है अभी, और हमने 158 मिलियन टन इस्पात की क्षमता देश में विकसित करनी है, जिसके लिए भारी भरकम निवेश की जरूरत है और इस्पात उद्योग में 7-8 लाख करोड़ रुपए निवेश होंगे। इसके साथ ही अप स्ट्रीम तथा डाउन स्ट्रीम में भी निवेश होगा। जाहिर है कि आयरन ओर की आवश्यकता वर्तमान के 180 मिलियन टन से 400 मिलियन टन बढ़ेगी, जिसके लिए लोह ऐश के खनन, बेनिफिशिएशन, ट्रांसपोर्टेशन, हमारे पेलेटाइजेशन जैसे अनेक उद्योगों में निवेश बढ़ेगा और रोजगार के अवसर उपलब्ध होंगे। हमारे देश में लोह अयस्क का प्रचुर भंडार है, जो कि लगभग 33 मिलियन टन है और दुनिया में 5वें स्थान पर है। भारत दुनिया का 4था सबसे बड़ा लोह अयस्क उत्पादक देश है तथा दूसरा सबसे बड़ा इस्पात उत्पादक देश है। लोह अयस्क की आवश्यकता को पूरा करने के लिए बड़ी संख्या में लोह अयस्क खदानों की नीलामी की जा चुकी है और आगे भी जारी रहेगी। इसके साथ ही डाउन स्ट्रीम उद्योग भी लगाने पड़ेंगे, जो ग्राहकों की आवश्यकता के अनुसार मूल्य वर्धित उत्पाद बनाएगा। इस्पात उद्योग में कल पुर्जों की आपूर्ति के लिए एंसिलियरी इकाइयों की स्थापना करना, इस्पात उद्योग में लगने वाले फेरो आयरन एलाइड जैसे कि फेरो क्रोम, फेरो सिल्कन, फेरो मैग्नीज जैसे अनेक योग लगेंगे। राष्ट्रीय इस्पात नीति 2017 में निर्धारित लक्ष्य को हासिल करने के लिए अपस्ट्रीम उद्योग, इस्पात उद्योग, डाउन स्ट्रीम उद्योग, एंसिलरी इकाइयां, ट्रांसपोर्टेशन, फेरो एलाइड, रेफ्रेक्ट्री आवश्यक इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर विकसित करने में बहुत भारी भरकम निवेश की जरूरत पड़ेगी। मेरा मानना है कि आगे 10 वर्षों में इससे लगभग 10 लाख करोड़ रुपए से ज्यादा का निवेश होगा। इससे रोजगार के बड़े पैमाने पर नए अवसर खुलेंगे। इस्पात उद्योग में निवेश की बात करते हैं कि तो कोयले की बात स्वतः ही हो जाती है। भारत में कोयले का लगभग 315 मिलियन टन का भंडार है, जिसमें लगभग 10% कोकिंग कोल का भंडार है। इसके बावजूद इस्पात उद्योग से लगने वाले लगभग 80% कोक की आयात होता है। प्रधानमंत्री श्री नरेंद्र मोदी जी के नेतृत्व में हमारी सरकार ने वाणिज्यिक खनन के लिए कोयला क्षेत्र को खोलकर एक बहुत बड़ा कदम उठाया है। वाणिज्यिक खनन के लिए हाल ही में समाप्त हुई नीलामी में बड़ी कंपनियों ने बहुत रुचि दिखाई है और लगभग 19 बड़ी खानों के लिए प्रक्रिया सफलतापूर्वक पूरी हो चुकी है। कोयले की अधिक खानों की नीलामी मर्चेंट माइनिंग पॉलिसीज के तहत की जा रही है, जिसके तहत कोयले का उपयोग बिजली के लिए या गैस, पेट्रोकेमिकल आदि जैसे अन्य अनुपयोगी अन्य प्रयोगों के लिए किया जा सकता है। गैसिफिकेशन प्लांट लगने से इस्पात उद्योग को ईंधन के साथ साथ प्रोड्यूसिंग गैस भी मिलेगा, जिससे आयात बिल को कम करने में मदद मिलेगी और गैसिफिकेशन प्लांट लगाने में ज्यादा से ज्यादा निवेश होगा। अन्य औद्योगिक खनिजों के लिए भी यही स्थिति है और मुझे पूरा विश्वास है कि हाल ही में खनन क्षेत्र के लिए घोषित नए सुधारों के साथ साथ देश विभिन्न क्षेत्रों में आत्मनिर्भर बनेगा और कोयला, चूना, पत्थर और बॉक्साइट जैसे प्रमुख खनिजों का आयात पूर्णतः बंद हो जाएगा, जिससे अंतरराष्ट्रीय खनन कंपनियों के लिए प्रवेश द्वार खोल देगा और निवेश बढ़ेगा। मुझे विश्वास है कि हाल ही में घोषित किए गए सुधारों के साथ साथ भारत स्थायी और सर्वांगीण विकास करेगा और आत्मनिर्भरता को मजबूत करेगा। हमारे माननीय प्रधानमंत्री द्वारा वोकल फॉर लोकल पर जोर दिया जा रहा है ताकि स्वदेशी कच्चे माल और उत्पादकों को निरंतर तकनीकी हस्तक्षेप और सुधारों के माध्यम से उपयोग किया जा सकेगा। आत्मनिर्भर भारत की बात करें तो यह आवश्यक है कि हम अपनी आवश्यकताओं को आंतरिक रूप से देखें, जैसे जब आवश्यकताओं को घरेलू स्तर पर जब इस प्रकार के पूरा करने का संभव ना हो तब हमें आयात के विकल्प को चुनना चाहिए। हमारे खनन उद्योग से सभी प्रकार के खनिज और क्षमताएं हैं। हमें अपने माननीय प्रधानमंत्री जी द्वारा निर्धारित मिशन में एक साथ मिलकर काम करना चाहिए। मेरा मानना है कि आज की चर्चा और मुख्य ग्रोथ ड्राइवर्स मुद्दों खनन और लोह एवं इस्पात क्षेत्र में चुनौतियां और अवसरों के बारे में उपयोगी अंतर्दृष्टि प्रदान करेंगे। मैं यहां मौजूद सभी सरकारी एजेंसियों और उद्योग जगत के प्रतिनिधियों से आह्वान करना चाहता हूं कि वे अपने बहुमूल्य इनपुट प्रदान करें, जो अपने आने वाले वर्षों में इस क्षेत्र में बड़े निवेश को आकर्षित करेगा और रोजगार के नए अवसर प्रदान करेंगे। विशेषकर मैं कहना चाहता हूं, मैं इससे सेमिनार में पूरे समय रहने का मैंने तय किया था, परंतु एक आवश्यक के अभी मेरा एक कार्यक्रम है, परंतु पॉल जी ने जो सुझाव दिए हैं एनडी में पर्यावरण पर और हमारे टूरिज्म पर निश्चित तौर से मैं इसको नोट किया है और मैं ये कहना चाहता हूं कि इसके बारे में एक बार हम मंत्रालय स्तर पर मंत्रालय स्तर पर बातचीत करने के बाद जो आप लोगों के महत्वपूर्ण सुझाव हैं उन पर जरूर हम आगे अमल करेंगे ताकि स्टील सेक्टर के लिए जो हमारे उद्योग क्षेत्र हैं हमारे अन्य सेक्टरों में और चाहे रॉ मटेरियल्स की हो हम उसके बारे में विचार करेंगे। मैं केवल इतना कहना चाहता हूं कि आप सब लोगों के जो महत्वपूर्ण सुझाव और विशेषकर जो पैनलिस्ट होंगे उन सब्जेक्टों में अलग अलग जो तकनीकी हमारे सेशन होंगे उनको रिकॉर्ड करके इन सारी चीजों को हम एक साथ बढ़ करके इस देश के विकास में हम योगदान कर सके, ये अपेक्षा मैं आज के इस वेबिनार से करता हूँ। पुनः एक बार आप सभी मित्रों को बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद, नमस्कार।
बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद मंत्री जी, आपने हमारे लिए टाइम निकाला एंड आपने इतनी अच्छी स्पीच दी। मंत्री जी को अभी जाना होगा, उनका बहुत ही जरूरी एक मीटिंग आया है, अर्जेंट मीटिंग आया है। हम सभी पैनलिस्ट एंड ऑडियंस एंड ऑर्गेनाइजर की तरफ से मंत्री जी बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद आपका। एंड बस आपसे एक बात बतानी है कि ये वेबिनार अभी लाइव है यूट्यूब पे एंड ये रिकॉर्ड भी हो रहा है। एंड वेबिनार के बाद हमारी टीम इसके ऊपर एक रिपोर्ट भी बनाएगी जो हम आपको प्रोड्यूस करेंगे, वो आप प्रेजेंट करेंगे। With this, we all like to thank Honorable Minister Fagan Singh Kulasthe ji. Thank you so much, sir. अब हम इसके साथ ही अपने next panelist के लिए move करेंगे. We have Mr. P. Madhusudan, Advisor of YSR Steel Corporation Limited. Mr. Shanmohan has not able to join us, so he will be presenting YSR Steel on his behalf. Over to you, Madhusudan sir. I will not take much time, so I'm giving the stage to you, sir.
Good afternoon to all of you and all those who are participating in the webinar. I, at the outset, thank Monika ji for organizing this seminar at a very appropriate time with a very appropriate topic. So the backdrop for the opportunities for mining and steel sector have been well highlighted by Dr. Nawal ji and Mantri Mahoday bhi apne speech mein kafi sare vishayon par uska touch kiya hai Mantri Mahoday ne. So I will not go too much into detail of the backdrop except saying couple of words on that. One is that we are all aware that the economic growth is back because we came out of the implications of the pandemic to a large extent, and almost we are near normal or to the pre-COVID situation in terms of the economic growth conditions. So as Dr. Nawal said, yes, we have learned the lessons and there are many takeaways also in the process the industry has learned through this difficult process. So the government came out with a budget which has a full thrust on the growth and reviving the investment cycle, and also the various schemes of the Honorable Prime Minister, the Atmanirbhar housing, affordable housing, and the thrust on infrastructure, the kind of investments which the government is going to do in the next few years in infrastructure. These are going to present a huge opportunity to the mining and metal sector in India. National steel policy is already in place where by 2030, another say 2030, we are expecting a consumption level of 230 million tons compared to maybe about 100 million tons of consumption now. So per capita numbers, again, if you dissect what Dr. Nawal has already mentioned, 75 kg at the country level, if you dissect into urban and rural areas, in the rural segment, it is still at abysmal, about 20 kg per man per year. So that again is a huge potential for increasing the steel consumption in India. So therefore, the targets under the National Steel Policy, hum log jo lagaye hai, jo 2030 ka 230 million tons, is achievable. The kind of opportunities that exist definitely make that number achievable. The overall economic growth predictions also, if you see, 6 to 7% over the next few years in India. So, and with the 1:1 correlation between steel use and the GDP growth. So that again indicates at a macro level, the huge potential that exists in the steel consumption growth that is going to happen. So therefore, on the other side, there is a opportunity for investment and growth in the steel capacity in India. So, of course, Nawalji again has highlighted few challenges actually for this kind of growth for the steel industry to happen. Maybe humko logistics ke upar jaroor dhyan dena hoga, jisme hum log sarkar ka kafi intervention ya support padegi, jaroorat padegi. Jaisa humko coastal shipping, jaisa hum log har ton ke har prati ton ka steel capacity ke liye 4 टन का हमको ट्रांसपोर्टेशन होता है, इंक्लूडिंग आउटगोइंग एंड इनबाउंड। तो उसके लिए काइंड ऑफ से अंदर 100 मिलियन टन ऑफ कैपेसिटी का इसका चार गुना हमको ट्रांसपोर्टेशन का फेसिलिटीज लॉजिस्टिक्स बिल्ड होनी चाहिए साइमल्टेनियसली, अदरवाइज द लॉजिस्टिक्स सेक्टर इज गोइंग टू क्रिएट हिंड्रेंस इन द ग्रोथ अपॉर्चुनिटीज दैट आर अवेलेबल टू दिस सेक्टर. सो सिमिलरली फॉर पोर्ट्स, बिकॉज अभी भी जैसा मंत्री महोदय ने कहा है कि काफी हम लोग को इम्पोर्ट्स रिड्यूस करने का काफी पॉलिसीज गवर्नमेंट लागू कर रही है, तो उसके मुताबिक धीरे धीरे हमारा इम्पोर्ट्स कम होंगे. बट आज का दिन इन द नियर टर्म में काफी हमको इम्पोर्ट इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर लास्ट माइल कनेक्टिविटी टू पोर्ट्स एक्सेट्रा को भी सुधारनी होगी टू मेक दिस काइंड ऑफ ग्रोथ अपॉर्चुनिटी पॉसिबल फॉर द स्टील सेक्टर. सो so many positives are in place and only the supporting role from the governments, I'm sure the steel industry is going to have a consistent decent growth in the years to come. And going back briefly, I would also touch upon what YSRCL is trying to do. So again, I'll divide it into two, three broad chapter sections. One is the historical background. So in Andhra Pradesh, of course, this is the corporation that has been created by government of Andhra Pradesh in the year 2019. The historical backdrop is that the YSR Kadapa district, where we are trying to establish the steel plant, is one of the most backward, underdeveloped districts as per Niti Aayog assessment also. So there have been aspirations of the people around this region to have a steel plant. In fact, the aspirations began as well as early as 2007-2008, where a steel plant was envisaged. And I am sure many of you would know that a steel plant in the name of Brahmani Steel was visualized in the year 2008 in that region. So first the land was given and a lot of efforts were made. Ultimately, it did not fructify for various reasons. So thereafter in 2014, when the AP reorganization has happened, again there was a promise in the reorganization act, jahan pe bataya gaya ki ek naya steel plant lagane ka ek explore kiya jayega naya the residual state of Andhra Pradesh mein, basically with a view ki the multiplier effect of a steel industry is well known. So in order to push and give fillip to industrialization in the new state, this kind of proviso was envisaged in the Reorganization Act. Of course, a lot of discussions have happened, and by 2018, ultimately the state government said, okay, we will move on with establishing a steel plant in this location. So that is how the concept of steel plant in the YSR Kadapa district started in 2019, and that the new corporate entity has come into work with the 100% owned characteristic nature of the company by the GOAP.
Madhusudan, sir, sorry to interrupt. Sir, you have 1 minute to go, sir.
Yeah, right. I'll just conclude quickly. And one thing which I would like to highlight is there are two things. I'll just say a couple of minutes, not more than that. One is the prerequisites that are required to create the steel plant. We have made very substantial progress. The land has been acquired. The land is a government land. It has already been handed over. The environment clearance process, which is not an easy task in a greenfield project. So I'm very happy to state that the appraisal was done, and we are waiting for the recommendations. The committee has already indicated that the environment clearance is going to be issued. So, and we have already taken a sanction of water linkage, the road connectivity, the power connectivity, which are prerequisites for the steel plant, are already put in place. And now, as an overall project strategy, in fact, the government, we are moving on with a very unique strategy. One is that we are looking to make it a PPP model, where we are looking to a JV, a very reputed partner, a player in the industry to join us, so that we can construct the plant with efficiency and operate it with efficiency. So while doing so, we also recognize the fact that people are hard-pressed really to make new investments, the existing players, because of the pandemic and the implications on the cash flows of the various companies. So we evolved a unique model where we said the government of AP would put the equity initially with a minor upfront equity from the JV partner. And once the construction is done, they will have to acquire a 51% stake from the GOAP. And thereafter, in another 5 years' time, the balance stake to be bought out. So this is one unique model which the parties got interested, and the process of taking the proposals is on. And we are quite hopeful that very shortly the proposals will get evaluated and the 3 million ton greenfield plant will be seen on ground. So I would like to only add one more aspect. On the infra side, again, we are keeping it as a separate vertical in order to make it very nimble-footed. The rail, road, water, power, all these connectivities, we are creating a new vertical. And this vertical would be supplying or providing all these facilities on a timely basis. They'll keep it ready and give it to the JVC of the steel plant on a user charges basis, so that both become lean and efficient organizations, and the total project can come on ground in the envisaged time. And this is model has been liked by a number of players, and we are very soon is likely to take on board a reputed partner to navigate this steel plant. So in this way, we also will be contributing to the national steel policy and the growth of steel industry in the country.
We will take up more points after once, you know, all the panelists will finish with their deliberations. And with this, right. I also like to congratulate AP government for planning this, plant that to be at a very, hard area where the need for infrastructure is very much needed, and I'm sure this plant will certainly help in terms of infrastructure as well as by providing employment opportunities. With this, I'd like to welcome our next panelist. We have Mr. Joydeep Bhattacharya, Managing Director of ThyssenKrupp Electrical Steel India. Joydeep ji, I will not take much of your time. I believe you have a presentation to make. So I'm making you a presentation. I'm making you a presenter. Please keep your PPT open, sir, on your screen. Can you see a message to show my screen?
The message, can you see my screen now?
Absolutely, sir. You can put it on slideshow mode. Your PPT is visible to us. Sir.
Yeah. So thank you, Monica, and good afternoon to all. Does not take much time. I present something on grain-oriented electrical steel. Monica has been after me for quite some time to present this topic, and somehow I couldn't make it. I'll divide this presentation into three or four parts. First part will be something about ThyssenKrupp steel, and then what we do in Nashik and what are the challenges. And Dr. Naval expressed it very well. I think some of the points already covered out there. I think the problems are the same for all the companies. So ThyssenKrupp is a global corporation with around 29 billion sales, with around 100,000 employees. We are there around in 60 countries. So by and large, this company operates in 12 key industries, automotive, construction, mining and metals, chemicals, white goods, aerospace, mechanical engineering, plant engineering. In India, we have Is the presentation still there with you all?
Yes, sir, very much.
Yeah. It's stuck on my end.
It's running fine, sir.
Yeah. Okay, so in India, we have around 9 entities which are basically from metals and mines, and from this mechanical and plant engineering, aerospace. What we belong to is part of this metals and mining and mine industry, and also part of ThyssenKrupp Steel Europe. So a brief introduction on electrical steel. Electrical steel, the world production is around 11, 12 million tons. And out of that, Geo is around 3 million tons, kind of. And Geo around 8 to 10 million tons. And today, I'll just focus on the grain-oriented steel, which, as you can see in the bottom of the presentation, it's basically in the transformer and the power distribution sector. And we are the only producers in India who make grain-oriented steel, and it was a lot of efforts to bring this technology to India. Of course, we had a lot of knowledge already on the non-oriented side, and so it was not difficult to start up this grain-oriented side, but we had to do a lot of investments on that. So electrical steel, as a glance, you can see that we are part of this ThyssenKrupp AG, which is ThyssenKrupp Steel Europe below it. And electrical steel has got three plants. That is in Gelsenkirchen, one in Germany, one in France, in a place called Lisburg, and here at Nashik. So together, we have a capacity of around 200,000 tons worldwide. And the two European plants have around 75,000 tons capacity. And at Nashik, we have around 50,000 tons capacity. We do the entire range of grain-oriented steel here at Nashik. A brief about this company. This company started in 1995. And in 2000, ThyssenKrupp came to India for this company when we were producing non-grain oriented steel. And by 2004, they were 100% owners of this company. Initially, we started with non-grain oriented lower end of the silicon levels, and slowly we mature into the higher end of silicons and doing low loss material. And that taught us how to make grain oriented steel because some of the technological parts are pretty similar. And of course, the big jump we took around 2016 to 2018 when we invested in into the complete technology of grain-oriented steel, where we started the production from the cold rolling stage. So we get our hot rolled coils from Europe because that's the only place which can source, because all these are pretty patented technologies. And normally you don't get hot strip material from the open market. So this was an initiative towards this Atmanirbhar Bharat and the vision of Honorable Prime Minister. And today we could at least proudly say that we brought into a new product into this country. Where does grain-oriented steel go? It goes into a transformer, as you can see inside. These are the cores inside a transformer. And probably this is the only steel where you can see the grains openly with the naked eye. No other steel, probably you can see such a big grains. And this is why it's called the grain-oriented steel, and you can do very thin gauges, and it's a very energy-efficient product. So what are the challenges? So despite being the only producer in India, as you can see this small chart which I put up, that we have got a lot of imports coming into this country, and many of them is driven from the Chinese producers, where they can really dump in India with their prices. And since India being a non-protection zone, like we have in MIP in Europe or anti-dumping in China, in India we have nothing like this. And because of that, probably it makes life more difficult, and the average prices in India are weaker by around $200-$300 compared to the world market. So what we request from the government, that we need some kind of protection for this kind of a product, or else there's always an excess capacity worldwide. And the businesses cannot be viable if we have that kind of pricing in India. Further, the demand needs to be created. The per capita consumption of power in India is nearly 1/10 or kind of that kind of a level. You can see some figures of the 935 kilowatt hour per capita consumption compared to US or Germany, where we have around 6,000 to 12,000 kilowatt hour. And so these kind of things needs to be done to create a demand. Otherwise, again, the sector cannot grow. Today, we have 300,000 tons as the Indian demand. And going forward, I think we should have around 500,000 tons of demand. And it can only come when you have these kind of policies to boost up the demand. The next point we have is, I just put out 2 points out here. In India, we have a high utility cost. So the power rates in India are nearly double than many countries. And also, we do not have a natural gas supply time. And we are not an integrated player. We have a coke oven gas or a blast furnace gas. So we need these kind of facilities to keep our business sustainable. And finally, of course, this is the same topic which Dr. Nawal said, that we need incentives to investments in new technologies and R&D. And without that, we would not be able to put in more investments for such a high quality product. Even the PLI scheme, which I think the government talks about melt and pour, which may not be sustainable for such a high value added product. Actually, you need to look into a value addition and then decide whether the PLI scheme can fit into the CRGO. And then only the focus of job creation and urban labor power can work. So by and large, I'd like to conclude my talk on that support mechanisms to build businesses and bring in more investments can only be done with some of these points which have been highlighted above. With that, I would like to end my session. If there are any questions, of course, you can let us know.
Sir, thank you so much, Joydeep sir, for making it really quick. And with this, I'd like to thank you, Joydeep sir. I know that you have a meeting to take up after this at your deliberations. So you are free to go. And thank you for taking out time for us. And our audience, moving on to our next panelist, we have Mr. T.S. Kathayat. Just give me a moment. We have Mr. T.S. Kathayat. He's the president and CTO of Wellspun Corp Limited. I'd like to welcome you, Mr. Kathayat, and thank you for keeping patience with us. So over to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Monica, for giving me this opportunity to share our vision for this investment opportunity in mining and iron and steels in India. And thank you, Mr. Vijay, and all the panelists, including the Minister of State as a chief guest. I'll just give you the brief of Wellspun Corp, what we do in terms of steel. And mainly, we are large manufacturer of line pipe steel, which is almost a capacity of 2.65 million tons. And we are the biggest user of HR coils and plates, and JSW is one of the main supply to us in the field of line pipes for oil and gas. And we do have four facilities, one in the biggest capacity of our line pipe manufacturing facility in Anjar. And the second one is when we started in Dahej, in the state of Gujarat again. The third one we installed almost 5 years back in the state of Karnataka in Bangalore. And recently, 1.5 years, we started another greenfield project of line pipes. Mostly, we are using the HR coils. There is Bhopal, which was inaugurated 2 years back in the state of Madhya Pradesh. So basically, we do have the other facilities globally, one in US and the four facilities in Dammam, which is Saudi Arabia. Again, we are the leading manufacturer and supplier to oil and gas big fours, including Aramco, British Petroleum, and Total Shell. We have been doing this project for them since last 1.5 decade. And globally, we do have a good supply record of value-added product. And in India, we started getting this API coils and plates from the key suppliers, including JSW, for the value-added product, where we had a lot of challenges maybe 6-7 years back. But now, at least we can say that we have been using almost a good quantity of HR coils and plates in India. And not only in India, also we are exporting to Saudi Arabia from our country, so that we become a good exporter of line pipe steels, which is a value-added product. And recently, we did declare about going for ductile iron pipe, a greenfield project, which is again in Anjar, where we'll be investing almost 1,200 crores in the coming years, and the project will be completed for DI maybe in 18 months from now. So that is our, again, one more verticals we are adding into subsidiary company, adding into the Wellspun Corp, that we are investing 1,200 crores for the DI pipeline, and basically to supply to the domestic demands for null to gel, and there are various missions of sanitations, infrastructures, and also the water, the potable waters and desalination plant are being installed, are being pushed by the government, where we have a good opportunity for going to go for this ductile iron pipes. And the total capacity of that would be around 350,000 tons annually. So we'll be able to have a good presence into the DI market. And the other one is basically, you see a lot of good demands in the domestic, where we are focusing on Atmanirbhar Bharat. And also what we need to do is we need to invest more in R&D, as JSW, my colleague, has said, that we need to have more investment and more focused on the R&D so that we get a good value-added product rather than importing those products from outside country. That is the other opportunity what we have, that we must focus on the value-added product where we are totally dependent on imports, so that we have to see a good opportunity we could see where we feel that the government has to push this research and development budget into the steel sectors. Coming to the stainless steel, I could see we just 1.5 years we started Wellspun Specialty Solutions, where we are mainly focusing on seamless pipes, and seamless pipe being used for refinery, for petrochemicals, for defense and aerospace. We have been doing this since 1.5 years, and we have a good, we could see a good opportunity in defense sector, aerospace sectors, and refinery sectors, where the stainless steel demand is going to up. And there are few players into these sectors who are, supplying good quality of stainless steel product. So we thought that these are the two new, focus area where we would be, going for these two new products into our forte now. And if you see the demand in our country, we could see a very huge opportunity for steel, not only for steel, even downstream product, what Minister has said, today, that this is what we should see, all the ancillaries and other product which are made of steels, and, see that what we today, if you see almost the DI, utilizations of DI pipes is almost 50% compared to MS pipe and HDP pipe and others, mainly for potable waters and other area. So I think I'm not going to take too much of time, and most of the things have been covered by everyone. So I would focus on three areas today. Even if we make a good quality of product and we are not able to supply to my customers without having a proper infrastructures, is the biggest challenge for me today. So today, if I'm able to make 24 meter pipes and 18 meter pipes, my infrastructure doesn't permit me to export, to supply these pipes by the road, by the rail, and also by the sea. As it, this is one of the biggest challenge for us when you produce a large diameter pipe and convert it into from plate to pipe and coil to pipe, and we are not able to export to the destinations. In that case, anyway, the project cost goes up, where the pipe has to be supplied in a shorter length rather than a bigger length, so that you minimize your project cost. So infrastructures like the road, rail, and sea is one of the focused area of this government. Is very, very important to make India Atmanirbhar Bharat. Even I'm not saying that it's only on the urban, but every industry, any industries, those who are exporting their product from our country to outside, they are facing a lot of challenges through the road, and even the rail is the biggest problem. So we have to have a good infrastructures focus in the future to come, to at least have a good supply chain system mechanism to become a good exporter and also a good consumption of steel from 24 kg to 160, 170 kg per capita in next 10 years. That's what I would like to convey in these panels, and because of the time limit, I could not make any presentations. But these are the two investment opportunities what we are going to do in next couple of years and 1.5 years, and creating the job of almost 5,000 people in this country.
Thank you so much, Mr. Kathayat, for telling us about well-spent plans and issues which are faced by pipe companies in particular because of the size and diameters and length. With this, I will move on to our next panelist. We have Mr. Anshul Gupta, project leader at BCG India. Anshul ji, I believe you also have a presentation, so I am making you a presenter. Please keep your PPT open on your screen. With this speed, I'm sure we will be able to have about 30 minutes of Q&A with the audience if we go like this. And I'm really glad today each panelist of ours, even the chief guest, made it on time. Anshul ji, your screen is visible to us.
Okay, great.
Yeah.
Thanks, Monica, and a good afternoon, everyone. So I wanted to take next 5 to 10 minutes to talk about specific investment opportunities in this sector in the state of Karnataka. And BCG is closely working with the government of Karnataka to create the right policy ecosystem to attract and create the right investment opportunity. So before I go there, just wanted to highlight few key numbers. The first one is, as we have discussed this in last 1 hour, that steel demand is already recovering back to pre-COVID levels. If we look at pre-COVID numbers, there was a 4 to 5% growth compared to previous year, 2019 versus 20. And during COVID, the numbers went down to as low as 87% versus again 2019. And in the unlock phase, now we are seeing ongoing momentum. Is my screen still visible?
Yes, it is. No, not now. You can again try.
Sure.
Yes, it is visible to us now.
Okay, great. So as I was saying that in the unlock phase last year of November, December, again, the production numbers have gone up. So this is a good sign. Again, as we discussed this, while the immediate focus is to recover from the ongoing pandemic, but it is important to have a larger in mind. Right, where the idea is for 2024 or 2030 to touch these numbers in terms of the production capacity as well as the consumption numbers. The four key areas of support which are needed specifically for greenfield expansion, because we discussed brownfield expansion, and we also discussed that how there's a need of greenfield expansion to reach the 2030 target numbers. So the first one would be possession of unencumbered land. There should be availability of iron ore at competitive market rates. There has to be a time-bound grant of clearances by the governments, including both central as well as state governments. And finally, there has to be the right logistics interlinkages to minimize the cost of logistics for transportation of raw material as well as finished goods. So with this overview, I just wanted to present a glimpse of Karnataka. As we can see, Karnataka is one of the leading investment destination states in India and is number one across parameters, whether it is total exports, across states, the number of R&D centers, and this is very relevant given we discussed a lot on the need to have R&D centers and R&D activities in this sector. Karnataka is number one in India Innovation Index for two consecutive years as released by Niti Aayog, and some of the demand sectors of iron and steel, whether it is machine tools or aerospace and defense manufacturing, etc. Again, Karnataka happens to be the leader among different states. The state has already a strong metal and mining ecosystem with basically about 2 billion metric tons of iron ore, about 74% of India's magnetite resources. The four districts which has majority of the deposits are Bellary, Koppal, Chitradurga and Tumkuru, and some of the leading the ISPs and companies are already present in the state. Now I wanted to draw everyone's attention is on the new industrial policy which has been released for the period of 2020 to 25 in Karnataka. It was released in August last year. The flagship incentive being offered as part of the industrial policy is a turnover linked subsidy, which is also known as investment promotion subsidy, and Government of India is also calling it as PLI, production linked incentive. So up to 2.25% of annual turnover for a period of 6 to 10 years and up to 40 to 60% value of fixed assets is being offered as financial incentive from the state to companies in this sector, which means if we look at the in NPV terms, the total incentive provided by the state to the industry, it ranges to be somewhere around 15 to 20%. And this has been a thoughtful move on the behalf of state to move away from SGST based reimbursement and other modes of subsidies to a turnover linked subsidy, where irrespective of sales in whichever state, or whether it is domestic sales or exports, on the total turnover, an investment promotion subsidy shall be given. Apart from this, there would be pre-setup charges which will be waived off, whether it is land conversion fee or stamp duty or concessional registration charges. And for anchor industries, which means the companies who are willing to set up a manufacturing plant in a taluka where there is no major industry, then an anchor subsidy of 70 to 10 crores shall also be provided. So this is the overview of new industrial policy, and we also discussed that for greenfield development, having readily available land, encumbrance free and clear title is important in order to ramp up the project construction. So Karnataka again has 10,000 acres of land available for investors, also including land which is pretty close to iron ore mines, whether it is Bellary district or Tumkur or Dharwad, across the state. Now, talking about the recent policy reforms being done to enhance ease of doing business in the state. So a Facilitation Act has been introduced, and basis which a 3-year moratorium has been put for approvals and clearances. So there are these 11 approvals. So the industries no longer require these approvals on day one before starting the project construction. Only one affidavit based clearance is required, and that is given by the state high level clearance committee chaired by the chief minister of the state, and basis that the project construction can start, and all these 11 approvals, whether it is a building plan or factory plan, etc., can be taken over a period of 3 years or start of commercial operations which is earlier. So just to summarize the offerings of Karnataka, I think the first one is the investor-friendly policies with very attractive financial incentives. The second is the readily available industrial ecosystem and land, revamped processes, for example, the 3-year moratorium, the availability of highly skilled and trained labor workforce, as well as relaxations in labor laws, which have been done recently by the state. The fifth one is the state has a well-connected logistics network, whether it is presence of airports or sea ports or national highways across the state. In fact, Karnataka is the only state to have two economic corridors, which is, you know, Bangalore to Mumbai and then Bangalore to Chennai. And the last one is that there's a good ecosystem of companies who would finally be end buyers or end consumers of steel, be it machine tools or aerospace and defense. So with this, I would like to conclude. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Anshulji, for your presentation. And indeed, Karnataka is quite an hot destination to invest with regards to the state location, the water and river connections, the ocean line, the coastal regions. And of course, how can we forget we have JSW Thurangalu plant there. With this, moving on to our next panelist, we have our last panelist of the day, Ms. Rumana Rahman, investment specialist, M&M at Invest India. Over to you, Rumana, and I believe you also have a presentation to share. So I'm making you a presenter. Just keep your PPT open. You will receive a message on your screen to share my screen. Yes, your screen is visible to us and you can go on to slideshow mode.
Okay. Absolutely. Hopefully my screen is visible, everyone. Good evening. And it's such a pleasure to speak at this event with among such eminent company. And you know, I don't want to take too much time because a lot of it has been covered by the various people as well as the Honorable Minister. However, I just briefly, my name is Rumana. I'm from Invest India, India's National Investment Promotion and Facilitation Agency. And I'll be taking you through the opportunities in the steel sector in India. And why are we talking about steel in India? The answer lies in the fact that India is one of the best performers in steel globally. India has shown tremendous growth potential in the steel sector since liberalization of the economy. The iron and steel industries are amongst the most important industries in India. Steel provided the backbone to India's industrial growth story, and the steel production has gone hand in hand with the increase in GDP. In 2019, India was the second largest crude steel producer after China, and the World Steel Association projected that India is on track to becoming the second largest steel consumer globally. And I'm sure these points have already been covered by the Honorable Minister. However, I'd just like to point out a little bit of the figures so that it's more clear on how well we are doing. When we look at India's steel capacity, it grew at 6.6 CAGR over FY15 to FY19, rising from 110 million tons in financial year 2015 to 142 million tons in financial year 2020. Indian steel industry is classified into three categories: major producers, main producers, and secondary producers. The major producers of steel in India by capacity are Steel Authority of India, or SAIL, Tata Steel, JSW Steel, ArcelorMittal Nippon Steel India, Jindal Steel and Power Limited, and Rashtriya Ispat Nigam Limited, RINL. These producers are a mix of PSUs and private companies. The National Steel Policy 2017 envisages an increase to 300 million tons of production capacity by 2030-31, and crude steel production is expected to reach 255 million tons by 2030-31 at 85% capacity utilization. Looking at the demand side, we can see a steady growth of 6% over financial year 2015 to financial year 2020, with demands of longs and flats remaining the same at the same approximate ratio. Steel's end user industry, especially construction and infrastructure, have tremendous scope for growth, which is also being aided in part with projects and initiatives of the government, which we'll talk about in the next few slides. Of the many projects announced by the Government of India in the recent years, there are six key infrastructure projects that are going to contribute majorly to steel demand. These are Housing for All, or the Urban and Rural Affordable Housing Project, which has a potential steel demand of 50 to 60 MT, Bharat Mala Project, the Pan India Roads and Highways Project, which has a potential demand of 18 to 20 MT, Sagarmala, the Port Modernization Project, which has a demand potential of 13 to 15 million tons, Freight corridors, which are railway corridors linking major manufacturing hubs with demand potential of around 6 to 7 million tons. Jal Jeevan Mission, which provides piped water connection to all rural households with potential demand of 11 to 13 MT. And finally, Udaan, the scheme which aims to construct 100 new airports over 20 years with 7 to 9 MT of potential demand. As you can see, even if we consider only these schemes, the potential steel demand comes out to be greater than 100 MT of steel. Some of this demand has already been realized, but potential remains great. Not only just projects, but government has undertaken various policy initiatives to support and promote steel making in India. The most latest of which would be the Production Linked Incentive Scheme, or the PLI scheme for specialty steel, which has been announced in November 2020 to promote manufacture of those grades of steel that India has low production capacity of and majorly relies on import for supply. The scheme, with an outlay of 6,322 crore rupees, covers the following types of steel: coated steel, high strength steel, steel rays, alloy steel bars and rods. This has been announced and will soon be implemented by the Ministry of Steel. The DMI and SP policy. This policy provides preference to domestically manufactured iron and steel products in government procurement for projects. It increases opportunity for domestic players to provide raw materials for these projects, which may be specialty in nature or otherwise may not have a customer base within the country, such as pipes for supercritical power plants, high-strength steel for infrastructure projects, etc. Steel scrap policy has been recently notified to facilitate and promote fair scrap processing and to ensure the adequate utilization of scrap as well as constant availability of it. It provides a framework to establish scrap processing centers in the country. Integrated steel hubs are being developed around integrated steel plants, which would establish both upstream and downstream clusters. Value-added clusters are being developed near demand centers to create a cluster-based ecosystem. We will discuss more on this integrated steel hub policy in the next slide. Additionally, in the latest union budget, the government has reduced custom duty uniformly to 7.5% on semis, flats, and long products of non-alloy, alloy, and stainless steels, as well as exempted duty on steel scrap for a period up to 31st March 2022. The government is also revoking ADD and CVD on certain steel products. These measures have all been initiated to incentivize steel manufacturing and achieve the national steel policy goal. For the final sector opportunity, I will take you through a key initiative announced by the government, Mission Purvodaya. Mission Purvodaya was launched in 2020 for the accelerated development of eastern India through the establishment of an integrated hub near Kolkata, West Bengal. The focus will be on eastern states of India, namely Orissa, Jharkhand, Chhattisgarh, West Bengal, and northern part of Andhra Pradesh, which collectively holds approximately 80% of the country's iron ore and around 100% of coking coal supply and significant portion of chromite, bauxite, and dolomite reserves. The integrated steel hub would focus on three key elements: capacity addition through easing the setup of greenfield steel plants, development of steel clusters near integrated steel plant as well as demand centers, transformation of logistics and utilities infrastructure, which would change the socio-economic landscape in the east. The object of this hub would be to enable swift capacity addition and improve overall competitiveness of steel producers, both in terms of cost and quality. And to achieve this, the government has put immense focus on enhancing the current logistics and power infrastructure, fast-tracking clearances, and providing encumbrance-free land, making available skilled workforce to improve productivity. When we talk of incentivizing manufacturing, a key investment promotion initiative taken by the government is project development cells. The Union Cabinet approved in June 2020 the setting up of PDCs in ministries and departments of the Government of India for attracting of investments. The mandate of the PDC is to provide support and facilitation to investors in India and to boost growth in key sectors. The PDC in the Ministry of Steel is being led by the Additional Secretary, Srimati Rashika Chaubey from Steel Ministry, and Mr. Ishan Jain from Invest India, who are working together to facilitate investors. I would just like to give a brief introduction to Invest India. It is India's national investment promotion agency under the aegis of the Ministry of Commerce and Industry. We work with all branches of the central and state government, as well as the industry associations and companies. Invest India provides assistance at all stages of investment for a company, right from the initiation of the investment plan to the aftercare of the project. As you can see on the slide, we have detailed the types of services we provide, such as market research on the company's product segment to location search along with the company, and providing continuous support towards all future activities. We would like to emphasize that all services provided by Invest India are pro bono, that is, we don't charge anything. To give you an example of the kind of services we provide, I can take you through a case of a client we're currently facilitating. A Russian CRGO manufacturing company approached us in 2016 and expressed intent of expanding into India. They wanted to establish a steel manufacturing facility, but they were unfamiliar with India's market. Invest India provided them with detailed market research and helped cement their investment idea. According to their manufacturing plan and company requirements, Invest India shortlisted three states which would be ideal as locations for the company's new plant. Invest India, along with the company, visited the sites selected and facilitated detailed tours of the locations. When the company further shortlisted two locations, Invest India gave detailed feasibility studies for both to help the company come to a conclusion. Invest India also facilitated multiple meetings of the company officials with officials from both the state governments, including the chief secretaries and the chief ministers of the states. Invest India then helped negotiate incentives for the company with the finalized state government, in this case, Maharashtra, as well as help in reducing the custom duty on the import of the raw material they would be using to manufacture. Presently, the company has purchased the land parcel at Auric, and construction has begun at the steel plant. Production is scheduled to begin by April 2022. This is just one example of the handholding we provide to companies that we facilitate. The metals and mining team at Invest India has extensive experience in handling clients and are diverse in their expertise. Please don't hesitate in reaching out to us in case you have India investment plans or even queries about the sector. Thank you so much. I'd really like to thank you, Monica, for inviting us to this webinar. And I hope I was able to shed some light on the kind of opportunities India has in the steel sector.
Thank you so much, Romana. With this, we are starting our panel discussion. We have started to receive questions also. One thing is there that when we talk about investment, the chain of other investments also follows. Like if we are talking about investing into mining, then beneficiation, then the labs, and then the slurry pipeline. Or everything follows with one industry, and then the chain industries also follows up. I like to first raise question from the entire panel. I request all the panelists to unmute their mics, and I'm going to take up our audience question also one by one. So the first question which I like to raise from our panelists is, since when you have planned your expansion or greenfield or brownfield investments, what kind of challenges you face in the beginning, and what sort of support do you expect from the government? As in, what is the primary challenge which any investor faces when it comes to greenfield or brownfield investment? We can start from Dr. Noble, then we will have Mr. Madhusudan, Mr. Katayat to respond to this question. Noble sir. I'm sorry. Yeah.
Monica, sir. You have asked a very right question to me. Somebody was talking about single window clearances. I say that has to be real sense, it has to be single window clearances. Though it is a single window clearances is there, but real sense it is not. And forest and environment clearances are one of the, very, very tricky and very tough. Second is acquiring the land. For us, there is no much problem in Karnataka, but other locations, it is really a problem. Land allocation and acquisition of the land. Second, water supply, that is another very big challenge for industry. And third is environment clearances. And this is the three major points I say government has to look into this.
Madhusudan ji, what is your response? As in what, since you are already setting up a new plant, it's a greenfield plant, what is the major challenge you are facing currently, sir?
Yeah, ma'am, I think Dr. Naval Saab has said, I think they are absolutely critical factors. So one thing which in fact many times derails a greenfield or a new project is the kind of clearances what you have to obtain. I think at the in the same breath, I would also like to mention or admit that the you will not believe that the environment clearance for our project, it's a ground greenfield, we applied last February, and this February we have been cleared. So by our own standards, it's a very we appreciate that there has been a lot of improvement in the entire system of giving the clearance. But still, yes, there are issues which can be done faster. That apart, in fact, the logistics part, which are single window, absolutely is without any doubt is a kind of scenario the industry would look to, so that you get going in the project without any delays and without overruns and time delays. Because as you know, any delay in the implementation would be a perennial burden in the cost efficiency of the project. So that is absolutely crucial. And then the last mile connectivity and the infrastructure like water also you mentioned. These are things when many times it keep bothering you to go ahead and put down your plants and start investing the money. So as far as our specific plant is concerned, again, it's a great pleasure that the state government is supporting it so well that the water linkage has been given immediately. The road linkage has already, the road construction has started to link it to the national highway. The power up to the plant gate already on deposit work basis, the APA transfer is executing. So that way, we definitely have started off on a very better note. But as an industry, yes, these are issues where you have to put in place the logistics necessary so that you don't stumble in the process of executing the plant, because heavy equipments have to move for erection in the site. So if you don't have right kind of logistics available to transport and handle them, so then you are stuck. So apart from single window clearance, and these are some issues which need to be definitely addressed and put in place to facilitate the implementation of the project.
Absolutely. Kathayaji, you also has commissioned your greenfield plant of ductile iron pipes. So what challenge did you face while making the investment on this plant?
The same issue of one window clearances, mainly on the environment and forest. This is the biggest challenge what we see. And it's not only on the domestic, even the new investment is coming to India. You know, we always share these things in the industries, fellows together whenever we meet. And this is the biggest challenge in our country, that still we say we have to make effective one window clearances right from top to bottom to give a good opportunity to the investors, those who are who wanted to invest. So Invest India should focus on some of the policy issues. Take those issues. I have been raising these points in various, take example of Vietnam, take the example of the way they get within 30 days of one window clearance to implement the plant. And here in India, we talk on the papers, but the real ground reality is a big picture, is what I can say.
I believe Invest India is working on window clearances, if I'm not, Rumana, if you like to highlight on that, because I came to know that the single window clearance, actually when the person goes on the system, we click on single window, but then 150 levels, you know, we have to cross. And you like to highlight on this, Rumana?
Yeah, so Invest India is working on the single window clearance system, and we've been partnering with a lot of companies as well as a lot of the ministries in collecting the data required to put it all together into a single window system in the first place. So a lot of compliances were not known until and unless you start applying for them. So for that we had to first collect that information through our various partners, through companies, where we figured out what are the kind of compliances needed to start a business for a particular sector, and how they can be brought on together into a single system so that all the clearances can go through the same dashboard. So for the environment, for the state clearances, it all should be able to go through the same channel. So for that, we are working really extensively. And, you know, we have those alpha and beta, trials going on, in which, however, it's a continuous process because there are multiple sectors and there are multiple compliances which may not be common for all of them. So individually, we'd have to compile a list of the compliances and then get different ministries and states to get them onboarded on that platform. So that sort of process is still going on. Hopefully, with your inputs, with the industry's inputs, we can improve that system and make it better so that it's more user-friendly. And any such compliances which may not have been onboarded, we can do it so.
Romana, maybe you can create a virtual storage also where companies can put their documents, and whenever they need any sort of license or they can just click on that option, and the storage automatically takes up the relevant documents which are needed, and they don't have to really upload and again prepare the things. It may save time. Moving on to the questions, so we have one question from Lakshmi Narayan. Chikatam Marla, his question is to you, Romana. Romana, he is asking, do you have similar investment facilitation for coal mining and associated services from overseas?
Yes, we deal with metals and mining, and we are also in touch with the coal ministry. So we do have, if any such investor is there who wants to invest within the coal mining sector in India, they're free to approach us. We don't, just focus on only on foreign investors. We see both foreign and domestic investors. And we deal with the Department, with the Ministry of Mines, with the Ministry of Coal, with the Ministry of Steel. And, our sector, especially mine, is both metals and mining. So we do look at coal as well.
Okay, we have a question from Mr. Rajiv Suri. He's asking, how land acquisition process shall be guaranteed to the investors? Since 2000, no ISP has been established in Eastern India, in spite of coal, iron ore, limestone, bauxite being available. Anyone can answer, maybe Dr. Noble would like to highlight. So how land acquisition, though it is a major issue which I believe every industry is facing, can be guaranteed to the investor? You have any suggestion to make, Dr. Noble?
Land acquisition, I can tell you, all the governments, they claims they have a special nodal agency and officer also there. But on ground, it is not helping much. Secondly, when there is a interaction with the public, and if any issues with the general, in society, that nowadays the government officials are not taking any active role in that. So my submission is, when you want investment, when you want industry has to come and invest, the industry should get a very fair treatment. Today, everybody thinks that once they invest, they have to find their own ways and means. That is not correct, actually. But with the pursuance, you can do it, and all the industries are doing it. But it needs a government special attention, actually. They have to have a special nodal officer, actually, who can real sense, who can work. It used to be 20, 25 years ago. But nowadays, it's very, very difficult, actually. Hardly any support is provided. But whenever government take it seriously, they do the wonders. It means government has power, government has will. If they want, they can do it.
Anshulji, I like to have your view since you're representing on behalf of Commissioner Madam from Karnataka, Trade Commissioner Madam. So regarding land acquisition, I like to have your view on behalf of Karnataka state government.
I agree with what Dr. Noble just said, that land acquisition on paper versus on ground are quite different. So I think one initiative government of Karnataka I wanted to highlight is the idea to develop industrial parks in PPP mode or SPV mode in collaboration with various leading private developers. And while this might not be relevant for ISPs because the extent of land needed and development scale is huge, but this is more relevant for small and mid-scale players in this space. So So the idea is that, you know, KIADB, which is the Karnataka's Land Acquisition and Development Agency, will acquire land, let's say, you know, 400, 500 acres to begin with. And that on that a private developer will come and the entire park development and trunking infra will take place in SPV mode. And then the SPV will be responsible, which will have equity ownership of both private developer as well as government for allotment of land and O&M of that park. So this will not only bring more transparency, but will also bring more efficiency and a better marketing and investor facilitation for that.
Right. We have one question from Mr. Santosh Kumar Ojha. This question is for Dr. Noval. He want to know what is the roadmap or timeline for JSW Steel's mega steel plant in Odisha near Paradeep, and what are the hindrances JSW is facing? Kindly put some light on the activities going on, sir. Sir, please unmute your mic. This one.
The land acquisition is over in Paradeep in Odisha, and we have recently got all permissions also, mostly permissions we have with us, and this forest and environment clearances also we got it. So now we are seriously planning actually start the activities there. But we are very much hopeful actually by Modi's 300 million ton capacity of steel industry in India. Before that, we will complete our project.
Okay. One suggestion from Mr. N.D. Rao to Invest India is that Invest India should work with Niti Aayog. One India, one signature approvals for investment. Mr. Andy Rao is representing Amalgam Steel. Earlier, he was a part of BRPL, Brahmani River Pellets. He was a managing director there. We have one question from Balram Bandi. He's asking, what will be the action to be taken by players or government to ensure quality, technically qualified labor is available for the huge increase planned in capacity? Anyone can answer. For qualified labors in the plant capacities, what kind of actions are being taken? I think it's related to the employment at the region.
I think
so, Madhusudan sir, you like to answer?
Yeah.
Madhusudan sir?
One initiative which the government has been doing is particularly in the all ministries, the skill establishing the skill development ministry. So, which has happened in the last maybe 5 years, that itself shows that there are regional skill development centers also under the Ministry of Skill Development, which have been continuously working on identifying skill set gaps that are existing for the metal sector, of course, steel in particular, and similar, I think, councils are there in all the ministries. So the government is well seized of the kind of skill requirements which the industries would need as they grow, as we go forward. And these councils are trying to take up, identify and take up various skill development programs to meet the industry requirements. This is one major initiative which has already happened under the initiative of the Government of India.
Right, sir. We have one question from Mr. Navadeshwar Kumar from Vedanta. He's asking a question to Mr. Kathayat. His question is, what capacity of DI plant and location Welspun Corp planning for commissioning? Kathayat, sir. Sir, please unmute your mic.
Yeah, so this plant we are installing in the state of Gujarat, very close to Anjar. Is a well-spent city in the same premises where we have the existing facilities. So the capacity of this DI plant would be around 350,000 tons per annum. But the diameter we can cover up to 56-inch, 48-inch. So that is not an issue for a smaller to bigger the way we are supplying to large. So it's in western part of India, state of Gujarat in Anjar.
Okay. We have one question from Mr. Rajesh Bisen. He's asking, how much is the investment in quality assurance laboratory and equipments for the enhanced capacities? Maybe Rumana or Anshulji can comment on this. What sort of investment are required for laboratories, quality assurance laboratories and equipment for the enhanced capacities? I think this is related to mining and beneficiation laboratories. So has anyone approached you to Invest India or BCG regarding quality laboratories investments?
So I think this is a very relevant suggestion. My only input here is that we need to create a business model around the testing infra, so you know, it becomes a business, and support from government would be required in terms of whether making the land available free of cost or some kind of subsidies, etc. And then the private players need to come forward and invest in this successful business model in order to provide the required infrastructure.
One more question to you from Mr. Mohammed Aziz Mullah. His question is, can you explain the single window clearance, land allotment, CFO, CFE, and etc.? Can you please brief on it and give any one ground example of any industry in Karnataka with regards to clearances and single window? Anshulji.
Yeah. So, single window is basically let's break it down into two parts. One part is the moratorium part, which means, a company needs to submit one application at KUM, Karnataka Udyog Mitra. That application will be considered in the state high level committee chaired by the CM if it is over 500 crores. And once that is the permission is given, then there will be a 3-year moratorium. And clearance right now need to be taken from each department. So what Karnataka is working along with Microsoft is to create a single window system where at one portal itself, only one application number or a file number will be created, and then that application or file will move internally from one department to another, so that the investor will not need to approach tens and twenties of departments to take different approvals and clearances. So having said that, this single window portal is still under development, CFO. So the industries are categorized into green, orange, and red, and there are defined time frames for providing those clearances. 30 days for green, 40 days for orange, and 120 days for red. So just 3 weeks back, Karnataka has issued a GO to cut down these timelines by 50%, so that for red categories now maximum approval time will be between 40 to 60 days. So right. This was an example on the initiatives being taken to improve ease of doing business and move towards single window.
Right. One question we have from Mr. Kiran Rao to Dr. Noval. He want to know, looking into the lower grade of iron ore in Karnataka, what are the new technologies adopted by JSW to use this low grade iron ore for production of steel? Also, what will be the impact on pricing by using low grade material, sir?
The Karnataka mostly iron ore is, you can say, up to 58 or maximum you can say the 61. So that needs the beneficiation, and we are almost from the beginning we are doing it. We are doing the beneficiation. We are improving 3 to 4 points, and we are making the pellets out of that. So there is very much required there, but there will be trailing losses are also there. So there is no economics when your iron ore prices are very, very high. Do the beneficiation, the losses are going to be there around 15 to 30%.
Right. Right, sir. With regards to mining, iron ore and coal, how do you see slurry, creating an impact in the near future? Because infrastructure is already a very big challenge, and all the material costs, whether it is steel or raw material, are directly impacted by logistic cost. So how do you see for raw material, because we only talk about slurry for iron ore, but never slurry for coal, though internationally at many countries, the slurry for coal has been implemented. So how do you see slurry playing its part in India?
The slurry for coal, for coke oven is not feasible actually. But slurry for thermal for power plants is possible, technically. The cost-wise is not much problem, but only the usage of the slurry from the coal and then make the use for making the coking coal is not possible.
Madhusudan sir, with regards to your steel plant, what are the plans of raw material acquiring and then taking to your plant? If you'd like to highlight on YSR plans.
Right, ma'am. Before that, in fact, on the previous question about the iron ore, as we increase capacities of steel in line with our projected 2030 policy, a national steel policy by 2030. So the slurry utilization of slurry is going to increase because that going forward that has to be used effectively by the steel industry. Otherwise, the key raw material availability for the steel industry, in my opinion, is going to become a big challenge. So now it is not very highly prevalent in India, but going forward, I think the slurry with respect to iron ore would become a more significantly or prominently used input for the steel industry. And of course, coming back to the next question which you asked me about the raw materials at Kadapa Steel Plant, one is as far as the two bulk raw materials, the coal part is, in any case, there is no low ash coal in India. And the plan is to link it through the Krishnapatnam port, which is a very ultra-modern port, which is available about 190 kilometers distance. So the linkage will be again through imports till such time that low ash coals are available in India. But one difficulty for the, even if low ash coals are available in India, we'll have to wait and see. That is a long-term perspective, is that the coals are available in the Far East actually. So we are in Far South. So how far the kind of quality which is available in India as we go forward would meet the requirements and also match the on a quality adjusted basis, the landed cost of the consumption at the plant. These are some things which have to be looked into as we go forward. But in the shorter run, we are linking it with the imported coal via Krishnapatnam. As far as the iron ore is concerned, again, yes, we have an MOU actually with NMDC to give a linkage of 5 million tons of iron ore, equivalent to 3 million ton capacity of a steel making at the location. But then one has to see is that from Karnataka, not much existing surpluses are available with NMDC. Two, there are restrictions about selling it without auction. So these could be two hurdles which might not fructify on a cost-effective basis, procuring from Ballari into this site. But of course, the plan B in any case will be that taking the material from Balladilla, which could again will be a little a longer distance and a higher transportation cost. Besides, in any case, you will have to be paying the market price. So that makes the viability more challenging. But considering that the iron ore is bought from Balladilla, the initial economics for the plant have been worked out. So it will be the plant will have to, particularly if you are linking iron ore from Balladilla, the plant would have to work very nimble footed on the conversion efficiencies, because both the raw materials, the coal and iron ore, are not going to be very, very reasonable in terms of at the input point. So that has to be based more on the nimble footed conversion efficiencies. So we are working on maybe to neutralize part of it. It's not a major element of cost in steel. Power, in fact, we are looking to how we can total waste heat and waste energy about 80 megawatts out of the total 225 megawatts of load that is required. About 80, we want to use waste heat, waste gas, and generate without having a thermal power plant. And balance, we are trying to look at maybe a kind of a deemed license. If you take as a distributor, whether it can give a cheaper cost of power than buying it from the grid. Or there is an option like Kadapa is a very high radiation zone. So maybe you can have a long-term agreement with a solar producer, which will be and that could give you power cheaper. So these are the kind of options we are looking to, that the high cost of maybe input prices at, or the bulk raw materials is neutralized. And the limestone and dolomite, they are available in the zone. Already there are steel plants around, except low silica lime, which again, India, it's not available in many places. It is available in Rajasthan at Jaisalmer and maybe a little bit in the state of Madhya Pradesh, Kuteshwar. So, but there, instead of that, in fact, RINL sale, most of the plants do import from the Middle East. So if you are closer to your importing, it is more efficient. So we will also be linking the low silica limestone requirement to imports. So this is the broad plan we have for the raw materials for the plant.
That is wonderful. So with this, I would like to end this session. Audience, with this, I would like to thank our expert panelists. We have, starting from our chief guest first, we had Shri Faggan Singh Kulasthe, Honorable Minister of State from Ministry of Steel. Our expert panelists, starting from Dr. Vinod Noval, Deputy Managing Director of JSW Steel Limited. We had Mr. P. Madhusudan, Advisor to YSR Steel Corporation Limited. Mr. Joydeep Bhattacharya, Managing Director of ThyssenKrupp Electric Steel Limited, Mr. T.S. Khatayat, Managing Director of President and CTO of Wellspun Corp Limited, Mr. Anshul Gupta, Project Leader at BCG India, Ms. Rumana Rehman, Investment Specialist, M&M at Invest India. Our sponsors of this program, starting from JSW Steel Limited, Rungta Sons Private Limited, and Smart System, Arthur Group, and American Steel, our as associate partners, Radha TFT and Super Shakti. And thanks to our lovely audience who never fails to make any session interesting. And audience, the recorded version of this webinar will be available shortly on our YouTube channel in 30 minutes. So in case you have missed any part of this webinar, you can go and visit to our YouTube channel and make notes. Or do not miss to subscribe to Metallogic YouTube channel for any steel and mining related videos. With this, I'd like to thank all our panelists and a very happy Basant Panchmi. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bye, everybody. Thank you. Thank you. Mr. Anshul Gupta. Thank you. 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 Very much.
Thank you.
JSW Steel is aiding growth in building the infrastructure that keeps the nation's heart throbbing. From steel that holds bridges and skyscrapers to steel that builds the railway coursing through the land, JSW Steel is the one name that does it all and stands strong.
In spite of spending millions of dollars, I always get outdated technologies from the global plant suppliers.
Hello sir, I am InSmart. I have been associated with the steel making industry for the past 27 years.
Okay, how do I jump from 110 to 300 million tons per annum?
I understand the intricacies of process control requirements and your requirements in Indian steel plants thoroughly. Right from run of mine ore to steel conversion at all the stages.
Oh, I see. How do I produce consistent quality steel?
I provide complete range of customized, end-to-end, sophisticated automated solutions, service support, and in-house manpower training, resulting in real-time analysis data for the process control and plant performance optimization at a rapid pace. Sounds impressive. Let's work together. I am at your service, sir.
InSmart Systems, reliable analytical support since 1993. InSmart improves quality, productivity, and profitability. स्टील टीएमटी महाशक्तिशाली
भूलोक का एडवांस्ड वाई रिब्ड सुपर शक्ति टीएमटी बार जो देता है सीमेंट के साथ मजबूत पकड़
और हर निर्माण को बनाता है
सुपर शक्ति से सुपर स्ट्रॉन्ग।